This is a combination of my videos covering representing information using bits and also parts 3 and 4 of my series, Programming and Assembly.
Have you ever wondered how computers can perform such complicated calculations only using ones and zeros? To understand how, let's start with something I assume you're very familiar with. As you probably know, we count using 10 digits, 0 through 9. This is called the decimal numeral system. Although we only use 10 digits, we can represent numbers larger than 9 by assigning information to the location of a digit in a number. After we reach our limit of 9, we add a new digit on the left that represents how many tens are in the number, calling this the tens place. Continuing this, once we reach the limit for the tens and ones place, we add a new digit on the left that represents how many 100s are in the number, calling this the hundreds place. Binary operates the same way as decimal. The only difference is that a new digit is added every single time all the digits are 1 instead of 9. The second digit from the right is the 2's place. To figure out what each place is in a number, start with the 1's place on the right and double the value every time you move left. To convert from binary to decimal, add the value of each place with a 1 and skip the places with a 0.
Not only can computers perform complex computations using 1's and 0's, they can also represent other forms of information such as characters. The implementation is straightforward. Almost every value of a byte represents a character. This is called ASCII, which stands for the American Standard Code for Information Interchange. The ASCII format is used to represent words and do things like printing to the console or editing files using bytes in memory. I'll show some examples of letters and their byte values, but note that they are mostly arbitrary. To view the list of ASCII values, you can look it up or just go to ascii-table.com. By the way, ASCII actually only uses 7 bits, not 8. Because memory is sectioned into bytes, the upper bit of an ASCII character is unused and set to 0. There do exist ASCII extensions that use the upper 8th bit, but there is no standard for this. Also, note that the value for a character representing a number is not the same as the value for the number.
Last video, we learned a lot of ways to define variables in our program's data section. Now, let's use this process to create our first program, Hello World. The goal of this program is to print Hello World to the console and then exit the program gracefully. Exiting gracefully just means exiting intentionally, preventing the program from reading data as code that isn't meant to be read. We start by creating our data section, defining a label that has the value of the address where the first character in the string Hello World is located. We use DB because each character is the size of a byte. The next section is the text section, which is where the actual code goes. We start by telling the program to start at the start label. You don't need to know how that works for now. Then, we have to utilize built-in actions that Linux has created for us. These are called syscalls. To use a syscall, you first move the value of the syscall you intend to call into the RAX register. For us, this is 1, which is the write syscall. Next, you pass each parameter that the syscall expects into the expected registers. The first argument goes into register RDI, the second into RSI, then RDX, then R10, then R8, and finally R9. The write syscall expects 3 arguments in this order: the file descriptor, the address of the first character in the string, and the length of the string. We pass each of these values into RDI, RSI, and RDX. The file descriptor for the terminal is 1. We get the address from the label called MSG, and we can count that there are 13 characters in the string. Finally, we write syscall to tell Linux to perform the syscall using the values that we set. Next, we will use syscall number 60, which exits the program. The exit syscall takes in an argument, which is the error code. The error code is useful for debugging because after a program runs, if it fails, you can tell why by reading the error code. An error code of 0 means the program ran successfully, so we will set RDI to 0. Again, we write syscall to tell Linux to perform the syscall using the values that we set.
Let's look at jumping in assembly. First, let's isolate the text section from our Hello World program and see what it would look like in memory. Each instruction is 64 bits long, or 8 bytes. The CPU executes each command one line at a time and keeps track of what line it's on with the program counter, or PC. First, it reads the current instruction it is pointing to, increments the program counter, and then repeats until the exit syscall is called, ending the program. Now, let's modify the program by adding a label before our first line and adding a jump command at the end. The jump command moves the program counter to the location of the given label. This creates an infinite loop, so we won't be needing the code that exits anymore. When the instructions are loaded into memory, the label that we created doesn't actually get loaded with them. It instead represents the line number of the next instruction, in this case 0. The location that the jump moves the program counter to is set to what the label represents. This program will continue executing until forced to end, so I recommend not running it yourself. If you liked this video or found it helpful, please consider subscribing and checking out the rest of the series.